including well-advised on other issues that inform an overall client-state balance. It's not just simply, you know, the legal infrastructure, you know, the bills of state planning or trust. It's also various constituent elements that go towards driving your wealth, which in turn or ultimately make Tom's businesses their advice is to be more holistic and to make a lot of use. One of the aspects in terms of capital acquisitions tax, we all know is that it's a very tight regime in terms of the number of substantial reduces, the very few left of those that might be there have been going on quite significantly over the last number of years. Insurance, I suppose, at one point in time was very popular and then it went down in terms of its popularity because of the cost were effectively, but now I think it's coming to a stage again where it does offer a technical solution to clients in terms of their overall tax mitigation strategy. So without further ado, I'll pass you over to Tom.
So I'm going to talk about section 73 first, because I'd say a lot of you are familiar with section 73, but I will come back to that. But section 73 is something that's not very commonly used. It's out there. In fact, even the life companies who are the people who have to provide these products don't necessarily know what they do and how they work. So it's something that we were looking into recently with clients that had problems and they wanted to find a solution. And that's, as you say, that's what we do. We do that in conjunction with state planning and solicitors, tax advisors. What we try and do is put essentially the financial plan in place for the client and then product solutions when they're required. But Section 73 is a revenue-proof policy. It's a savings plan. So if you didn't have the Section 73 trust on it, it's just like any savings plan you'd have with any life company where you'd be saving for your children's education or to buy a house, whatever it would be. There's nothing unusual about the product per se. But you add this Section 73 endorsement effectively to it, and it takes on a different character and it has certain tax treatment. And I think it has particular attractions at the moment because of some of the things that have happened over the last few years, changes that have taken place in some of the reliefs. I'm going to try and explain that to you. This is something that's come up in talking to some tax advisors and solicitors over the last few months about this product that I think are probably particular problems out there that this can help solve. So effectively the relief is such that if I want to give some money to my child, let's say, in 10 years' time, that's going to have a tax implication, as you know. So if I want them to get this net sum of money, I'm going to have to give them a larger gross sum of money so they get the net sum. Or what is more likely to be the case, if I want to give them a property, let's say I've decided I want to, I've got two little girls, let's say I want to give them an apartment each when they're 21 or something like that, those are the numbers. I know for them to get that without any tax implication, I'm also going to have to give them a lump sum of the cash so that will pay the CAT, assuming they already use what they're using, of course. And that lump sum of cash that I'm going to give them as well to pay the taxes in itself are taxable. So I effectively, if I want them to get 100,000 in cash to pay the tax on the apartment, say it's a 300,000 apartment, I have to give them 150,000 in cash because that 150,000 is also going to be taxed at 33%. So these policies, you can accumulate that, let's call it 100,000 that you want to give the child to pay the tax on the 300,000 apartment, and that 100,000 is in itself tax-free. So you're it's very straightforward saving of 50,000 euro effectively. The numbers are not exactly precise, but you get the idea, you know what the tax rates are. And one of the things in comparison to Section 72, I think a lot of people over the years have always had slightly conflicted ideas about Section 72. Is it just too expensive, or how can I be sure I'm going to want to do this, or what if my circumstances change and I might not know if I really want to leave this money to my children, or I might not have any money because I might spend all the money in my retirement. But Section 73 is much more certain because you've got a fixed period of time, you accumulate the money over that fixed period of time, you hand it over to the children and they receive it tax-free. There are certain conditions, they have to use it within a certain particular, and I can say, well, you're not getting that anymore, I'm going to keep that. If you pay premiums for a Section 72 policy and you stop them, the policy's gone, the whole thing is wasted, although I'll come back to that because that's not entirely true anymore, there's a new product. But Section 73, you can change your mind and decide to hold on to the money. One of the problems that arises when you think about that is that, let's say I have two apartments and I want to leave them to my two daughters and it's in 10 years' time, the same argument. I want to accumulate the money so that they can get the apartments tax-free and I've already given them money so they've got no cash outs left from that. The difficulty is I don't know what that apartment's going to be worth in 10 years' time. Let's hope it accumulates in value. So I have to accumulate enough money, but it's a kind of variable sum of money because it has to be enough to pay the tax on this apartment. And the longer time goes on, assuming the market's positive, the bigger that tax liability is going to be, because presumably the bigger the value of the apartment's going to be. So you can actually use it in a slightly different way. And you can use it to solve the problem that's out there, because I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with private dwelling relief and what happened there. And I think a lot of people found themselves in a scenario where they bought a property for a child, they intended to hand it over to the child after 3 years, and then the rules changed, and they can't do it anymore. And I know that in certain cases, what people decided to do was to effectively lend the children the money to buy the apartment from the parent, because they wanted to find it out. They decided they were going to pass this property over to the child. And that actually makes this scenario even more suitable and more tax efficient in a way. Because now you've got a fixed amount of money that you need to sort out in 8 years' time. So if I actually lent my daughter the money now to buy an apartment from me for 300,000, she now owes me 300,000. But that 300,000 isn't going to change. So I'm not dealing with a variable amount of money anymore. The apartment can grow as much as it likes. It doesn't matter. It's not going to change the tax problem. Now, I know there's an implied interest rate to cover that, but it's a lot less than the implied value of the rental if they were living in the apartment tax fees. It's a very small amount in the current environment with interest rates being so low. So you could actually say, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to forgive this loan that you owe to me in 8 years' time. All of the things we need to have, that loan amount is going to change. You can sort out the annual imputed interest with the annual gift tax exemption, probably given the amount. And then you just accumulate the 100,000 in one of these policies over those 8 years, hand it over at the end, the loan's forgiven, the tax is sorted out, and you haven't had to give them 150,000, you only had to give them 100,000. So that is something when we started looking at this area that perhaps we didn't have in mind. We just wanted to go out there and talk to people about this. But in talking to tax advisors, you have your clients and you know what their issues are. This is something that's out there. But it also then gets you thinking about, well, what do I want to do this in the future? It's nothing to do with private dwelling relief. But yes, I do want to pass over assets to my children, and I want to do it in their lifetime. It doesn't have to be the children, it could be anybody. This is a way to do that much more tax efficiently. And I've learned one thing from dealing with tax advisors and solicitors over the years, and trust and estate planners. You don't like uncertainty, if that's fair comment. You like things to be locked down and to be certain. This is really pretty predictable. The only unpredictable element of it is, you know, the clients get to pick how they want to invest this thing. So they're accumulating the 100,000, let's say, to pay off the cash, the tax on this loan. But they can choose to invest it in an equity fund, in a cash fund, in a property fund, any of the normal funds that you find that, you know, Aviva, Standard Life, Irish Life, etc. would make available. But that's part and parcel of what we do. We sit down with the client. Because in theory, if they're trying to accumulate 100,000, they don't actually have to put away 100,000. If they're doing it over a period of 8 years, they might have to put away 65,000, 70,000, depends how much it grows by. And that's their own personal choice. It doesn't have to be 8 years, it could be 9 years, it could be 10 years. It has to be at least 8 years. And we're independent advisors. That's obviously part of our USP. So prepared to say, I went out to all the life companies when I was preparing this note and looking at this whole area, and a number of them didn't have a clue what I was talking about, to be honest. But some of them did, and they're all now attuned to it. I'm probably not the only person now in town thinking about this. And so they are now developing products in this area. But there are products out there right now today. The client comes to us, and one of your clients wants to solve a problem like this, it can be done right now today. But there's really nothing unusually special about this product in simple terms, other than that it has an endorsement so that it is considered Section 73, because otherwise the proceeds are not tax-free. But actually that's something we believe and we make sure it's all done properly. One of the things we do is, you know, we work in conjunction with solicitors and tax advisors to try and create a plan, and you'd be trying to put a variety of things in front of people, because as you know, you can't always solve problems with one particular solution. So, you know, if somebody's got tax issues, COT issues, they want to pass money over to the next generation, they need probably a suite of solutions. They might be doing something very sophisticated, like offshore maintenance or whatever they might be, but they might be just looking for plain, ordinary, everyday type solutions. Another thing that isn't even on here is, we find very popular with people, is the idea of just putting away $6,000 a year for each of their children, and you know, you start when you're young and you want to pass over money to them. Normally what we say to people is, this is for the time when your children turn around to you later in life and say, I want to get on the property ladder, can you give me $100,000 or something? You want to be prepared for that. As you know, they have restricted the amount that you can spend on your children, how much you can support them in the taxation of all of that. So that aspect is, I'm sure you know, you can give $3,000 to anybody you want, the man in the street if you like, but to your children each year. So if you just formalize it in a particular savings product, you can give each of your children, you know, if there are two parents, you can give them $6,000 each. And over a period of 15, 20 years, that accumulates to a lot of money. What I'm going to say to people is you've got a $300,000 lifetime limit for your CAT, or, you know, approximately. But you can double that with this very simple measure of $6,000 a year if you start when your children are very young. Now, obviously, you might want to use it for something like education, which isn't a taxable gift anyway, but you can use it for whatever you want to use it for. But if they do turn around to you and say, we want to start a business, we want to buy a property, the thing that, if you're in a happy position to help them, this way you can do it tax-free and it doesn't come out of their lifetime allowance. I find that's something that's very popular. Again, because it's certain, you know, people can decide how they want to invest it. They can also decide, you know, at what point in the time they want to tell their children about it. If it's done in the right way, the children don't need to know anything about it. Because people often have a concern, you know, what if they get to a certain age and they're going to turn around and take the money and buy a Maserati and sell it into the nearest tree. Well, they don't need to know it. I have for my two daughters, it doesn't go to them. The post doesn't have their name on it, it's my name. So they won't find out until they turn around and ask me for money. But the other element in this, if you like, there are three elements, is Section 72. And Section 72, I've been in this, our business is 30 years old. My father founded it originally. My father and my mother worked in the business, and then I got involved and bought them out. It's now 12 of us in the business. It's got bigger, but one of the biggest independent financial advisory firms around. That I can remember back, and we still have clients with Section 72 policies from the time when it was popular back in the 80s and the 90s, and they were with profits type policies and down policies. You might come across that type of thing. Don't know exactly why they went out of fashion in the early part of this century, you can put it that way. I they did get a bit more expensive. I actually think the product structures changed, and the life companies took a while to get around to coming up with products that were clearer, because the old products had an investment element in them and people felt they were going to grow particularly strongly, and that attracted people to it. But I don't think the underlying cost of life insurance got any in the ratio. I think part of it, to be honest, is because you guys are so clever coming up with ideas that people didn't have to pay tax at all, that the idea was planted in a lot of people's minds that inheritance tax was something that was there in the statute that you didn't really have to pay. If you were smart, you'd find a way around it. But slowly but surely, the revenue caught up with all these reliefs and they're gradually being chipped away at. So it's very difficult to get around it anymore. And certainly a number of people have said to me in the last few months that this is coming back on the table, because it's Section 73, when the gift happens on death, it's the same idea, the main difference being that this way, you're paying a premium into a life policy. There's no investment element. It's like insuring your car or your life. It's a lump sum of money that's going to be paid out on your demise. And as long as it's paid out to your children and structured in the right way, that money is tax-free and it solves part of their tax problem. I think one issue people have about it is, well, how long am I going to live? I don't know if this is good value, because I don't know how long I'm going to live, so I pay a certain premium. Maybe I'll end up paying more out in premiums than I'll ever get back in cover, so maybe it's a waste of money. But certainly the cost, because it does to a certain extent come down to cost. The cost now, I put an example on there, and I would say that broadly speaking, when people take this out in their 60s, let's say, they would have to live beyond the age of 100 to end up paying more in premiums than their children are going to get back in cash to pay off their tax. And I think, for whatever reason, most of the clients that I deal with, they seem to gravitate around the idea they're going to die when they're 85. They're not all going to die when they're 85. I don't know how people can possibly know that. But very few people think they're going to live until they're 100. Until you tell them, well, if you pay these premiums and you go to children, you die when you're 85, then the children are going to be much better off. And they say, well, maybe I'll live to 100. So it's psychological thing, because obviously nobody knows how long they're going to live. But obviously not many people live till they're beyond the age of 100. But I think when you do the numbers and you factor in the tax saving, for the sake of argument, let's say it's €1 million, you've worked out that you will, over the 30 years, let's say, or 35 years, you start when you're 65, you will pay €1 million in premiums over that 35-year period, so between now and age 100, if you did age 100. They think, okay, so the family will be in profit if I die before I'm 100. But you really have to factor in that the million that the children are getting, again, a bit like Section 73, is really worth €1.5 million to them, because they're going to get that million tax-free to pay down the tax on the rest of the estate. If you wanted to give them €1 million, net of the tax, they'd have to be getting €1.5 million. So if you factor that in, and you can take different views on that, but if you factor that in, well, then they have to be living until they're 120, the oldest person ever to have lived, to end up paying more in premiums than the children will ever get back. And we can obviously put numbers in front of people. You can do this when you're younger, and it's obviously the numbers look a lot better, but that's really just the power of compound interest. Sometimes you do this. If somebody decides they want to take this out in the 50s, obviously they'd have to have a very good idea of how much their estate is, and they'd obviously have to have a lot of surplus cash to know at that stage in their life that this is going to be a problem for their children later on. But if they do, the numbers are even much more attractive. You're going to have to live to 120, never mind the tax, before they end up paying more in premiums than the children would ever get back. But there is a new product that's come out in the market that, again, we're independent advisors to say, so what we do is we go around to the different life companies and we get quotes depending on certain circumstances, and there are certain restrictions. For example, most of the life companies have a maximum age limit of 75. So you have to do this before you're 75, or you can't do it after that. Don't ask me exactly why they have that. It just becomes prohibitively costly, or the life expectancy figures around it just make it impractical for them to do it. But having said that, there is one life company, because we're just doing it for somebody at the moment, where they have more flexibility and they can make arrangements. They can do it at any age they want, but they do it on a case-by-case basis. So flexibility out there. And the people who are the best value chains was Irish Life for a while. It's probably Royal London at the moment. Aviva can do other things that others can't do, larger sums, because Zurich and Irish Life were the two that had probably the bulk of the market, but then they both imposed restrictions that the amount can't be more than 500,000 in one case and 1 million in another case. And obviously that's a substantial stake by most people, you know, that's a very substantial tax bill on an estate for most people. But Royal London have now just, they launched a product earlier this year, and they've just increased the limit up to 5 million, in fact they'll consider amounts up to 10 million. That's all to do with who their reinsurer is in the background. It just gives them more flexibility. But the other thing that Royal London have done in their product, which I think is popular, is that they have introduced, I suppose, an element of conditionality into it. So some people are concerned, as I said, they'll pay these premiums, and then for some reason their circumstances will change, and they won't want to do it anymore. They've fallen out with their children, or something's happened in their life. They had loads of property and debt, and they blew themselves up. They've no money anymore. Anything can happen. So people are concerned about entering into this unless they know that they're going to get a benefit. So Royal London have two options. You pay a little bit extra at the beginning, approximately 15% extra. Don't have to do it. It's just an option you can choose. And once you've been paying for 15 years, you can then just decide to stop paying. And then you either get a certain amount of the cover you had at the beginning, and you hold on to that for the rest of your life without having to pay anything else. Or you can get a proportion of the cash that you've paid up to that time back, and the deal is off. Okay? So, for example, you can pay for 15 years, circumstances have changed, you don't have as much money as you thought you did, you're not really going to be, or let's say the inheritance tax thresholds go from 300 odd thousand to 3 million and nobody has to pay any tax anymore. It seems unlikely, but it's theoretically possible. Mm-hmm. So they say, well, okay, I want to stop paying that after 15 years. They'll give you 70% of what you've paid back to you. Okay? Or, depending how far after the 15 years have gone, they'll say, actually, you can have 60% of the cover you had initially, or 70%, or 80%. It depends how far down the line you've gone, but you don't have to pay anything anymore. And that apparently has proven very appealing to people. They may never avail of it, but at least now they know it's not just a one-way bet, that if circumstances change, they can get their money back, or they can just stop paying. And sometimes I wonder how they can make these so cost-effective, because you look at it and you see, if you do the numbers and you actually work out like the return on your money in certain circumstances. So if you assume someone is such and such an age, and they're going to die at such and such an age, and you work out how much money is going to be paid out in premiums, and how much money they're going to get back, the effective returns for the clients are like 10, 11%. You think, well, how can that be right? Because they never give you 10 or 11% when you invest in one of their funds. So how can they be doing it in this policy? Is there a trick? Is there a catch? There isn't. The reason they can do it is because quite a high proportion of the people who take out these policies don't finish paying them. And the premiums just go back into the pot of the life company. And they've wasted all their money. And it, not just Section 72, but just more broadly speaking, their pot, their risk pool. And they can use that profit margin that they get to make this more cost effective for the people who do keep paying the premiums. So, obviously, rule number one, if you take one of these things out, don't be the mug who takes it out, pays it for 10 years, and then stops. Because all the premiums you've paid for 10 years have been a complete waste of money. And the other person who does keep paying is getting the benefit of your waste. But that is part of why it is actually quite cost effective. I think it's important to understand that, because sometimes people look at the numbers and they do wonder if they can be correct. Because I've seen clients come back to me and say, oh, I'm wasting that. I just don't quite understand how they can do this. Part of it is, obviously, they invest this money and they try and make money out of it, and they've got their own internal returns on capital, so they're factoring that into what they do with the premiums over the years. But part of it is just purely the claims experience, and the fact that they don't necessarily have to pay out. But I also would say, you know, when does this come into play? When is it a good idea? I mean, that's obviously one of the things that you guys decide with your clients. But rule of thumb in my mind, clients have to know that their basic needs are covered and that they have enough capital for their own retirement needs. And it's only the money that they're never going to spend that they should be reinvesting in this, in my personal view. I mean, different people would have different views, but for the sake of argument, let's say somebody said they had 2.5 million, seems like a lot of money. But if you knew that they wanted 80-odd thousand a year for the rest of their life, if you run the numbers, they want to even take a fair amount of risk to make that 2.5 million, produce that kind of income for the rest of their life, assuming, because you've got to assume they live to 100, that's what we do, we always assume conservatively how long they're going to live. So they can't really afford to take anything out of their 2.5 million, roll it back into the pot for their children, as much as they might like to. Now they can, but then they've got to understand that they're restricting their own income, because there's only one pool of, this money, these premiums are going to come out of their own pool of retirement capital, effectively. But if those same people have 5 million, then you're saying to them, well, if there's 2.5 million there, that's what you need, the other 2.5 million you probably never need. You could invest that other 2.5 million or some of it, it could produce an income from an investment. You could cycle that income back into this Section 72 policy for your children, thereby essentially ensuring that they get some or all of that 2.5 million tax-free when you pass away. Everybody has their own line as to how much capital they need. And of course, the big issue nowadays as well is that even with that figure, which I just tend to carry around as a rule of thumb, 2.5 million is what I tend to find my clients, they want 70,000-80,000 a year, 100,000 a year as income. You know, if they're a professional couple and they've been doing well in life, that's what they think they need to comfortably live on. Sounds attractive to me. But they might, what if they also need nursing care? And, you know, that's an unknown quantity and it's not insurable really in this country. So, you know, maybe there's a greater sum of money they need to set aside. But there again, I had this client the other day, and he is he's a well-off man. He's got about 6 million. And I remember the first time I sat down with him, I said to him, you know, you've got 6 million, you've got loads of property, you've got equity, you've got investments, all sorts of things. And his children are all financially independent, and himself and his wife live in Dublin, and no mortgages, no debt, nothing. And I said, like, how much do you spend? And he said, like 30,000. And I said, okay, you mean a month? And he said, no, I mean a year. And I said, okay, so what's the purpose of all this money? And he just couldn't really answer the question. I didn't really understood the question, to be honest. He just likes accumulating money. He's in his 70s, likes accumulating. He has no idea what he's going to do with it. So you would think that he's the perfect person for this. He's got more money than he's ever been spent. He'll never possibly spend all this money. But I put the idea to him, and it just came down to cost. He is going to do it. But I said, your notional tax liability there is in the millions. He's got 3 children, and they're not particularly well off. And he doesn't seem to want to give them anything in their life. I passed my judgment on that. He doesn't seem to want to. But when presented with the opportunity of making this sort of less taxable for them, he's open to that idea, but I find you've always got to leave room for maneuver. Like you can scientifically or mathematically work out what the liability is going to be, and et cetera, but it's very rare that a client will actually try and pinpoint the amount that the liability is and insure the whole thing. So in this case, he's going to insure himself for maybe 500,000 or something like that. But he should be insuring himself for probably, at least a million. But when I say should be, he doesn't have to. I mean, you don't have to. The children, a lot of people take with you, they let them pay the tax and understand the enormity of what we're doing for them and giving them this money. But as I say, those three elements are kind of the solutions that we would put in place for people. And as I say, we do it in conjunction with people like you. So if you have clients in this sphere, we'd be very happy to look at. A few more things I could talk about, but I am conscious of time. Does anybody have any questions?
Just a bit more London policy, the way it works,
the policy, what sort of level of recoverability is there for those who use it as a quasi-savings policy with their premium? Like, how many years do you have to decide at one point? I understand the Royal London one, but you do have another premium.
Yeah, it has to have out 15 years.
15 years.
Yeah, they, it's, if you stop it before 15 years, it's gone. And if you don't pay the life stages, I think they call it, it's extra 15% at the beginning. You know, it doesn't matter how long you pay, you can stop, you get nothing.
And do you get all of the return, or does it cap that on the threshold in terms of the return?
The way they do it is, if you pay this extra amount, you would only ever have to pay the premiums to age 100. And depending on the age you were when you started, they work out what proportion you are then aligned to at age 100, and they give you back the sum of money in proportion to, you know, how far you are down the line. So if you start when you're 70, there's a metric. If you start when you're 50, there's a metric. So you, and you can be told, you'll be told that at the outset. There's a lady here who wants to ask a question.
Just in relation to that, you mentioned how people may not know what their tax liability would be after.
Yes.
But just to confirm, if they had a lower tax liability than they had budgeted for, that goes to the children as a taxable.
That's right.
You
don't lose
the
money.
There's no loss on this.
No, there's no loss. It's just that part of it will be taxable. One other factor that I think is very important, we always tell our clients, you should not do this without getting independent legal tax advice before you do it. I don't know whether all the clients do that. Obviously, a lot of them come to us from legal and tax advisors, so we can take this read and we're liaising with people. We know they're getting it. But if we have a client that we're speaking to who just wants to do this product, we tell them to do that because, for example, let's say they have a will, discretionary will trust, if I get the terminology right, you guys are the experts, that it may well be that there's a structure in place for some other reason that the parents think that the children are going to inherit the money on their demise, but maybe they aren't. Maybe the money's going to go into a trust for a number of years because the children have debt issues or there's some other reason why that was done, or the children are minors or something. Well, the tax liability has to actually arise within 12 months, I think it is, of the policy coming into play for this money to be tax-free. So it isn't always the right solution, or at least it has to be done in conjunction with the right type of will. You have to make sure that the will is correct, and we would see at the bottom of all our letters that go to our clients. We are not tax or legal advisors. You should seek independent tax and legal advice because we just don't know. A lot of clients don't know themselves. But as I'm sure you know yourselves, I have dealt with quite a few solicitors as clients and partners and law firms, and there's one firm which will remain nameless where I think a half dozen partners in there, but certainly the first four, not one of them had a will. You know, so the cobbler's children, they shot it last. It's amazing to us how often people have made any kind of will, never mind a proper will. Whereas people will tend to have a tax consultant when they come to us because it's kind of an annual thing they have to do, but they tend to put the will out of their minds because, you know, people don't die when they're young, they die when they're old, so they don't have it. So, yeah, that's a factor to bear in mind. Yes?
If a plan takes out a Section 73 policy that dies within 8 years, will it qualify as a Section 72 automatically?
It has to have a certain amount of life cover attached to it at the outset. Mm-hmm. And you may or may not choose to do that. It depends how you structure the policy. But if you do it in a certain way, then yes, it is. And vice versa, I should say that if Royal London, their policy, which is Section 72, if you use it and you have this life stages option, pay the extra 15%, and you choose to stop paying and get the money back after the 15 years, it can be used for Section 73. So if you decided you were going to gift money at that point rather than wait until you were dying, you could do that and do it in reverse. So it can work either way, but you have to be sure you structure it right in it. Right? And you can't really do that down the line. You have to do that at the beginning.
Is there tax relief as well on those premiums?
No, the premiums have to come out of your after tax, and they have to be paid by the person who's giving the money. They can't be paid. That's something that comes up. Section 72 children are thinking, could we pay? You can't. Now, does it happen that the parents are paying it and the children are somehow supporting the parents in some other way to make sure that they keep paying it? I'm sure it does. But strictly speaking, the premiums have to come.
policy is for the joint lives of two parents.
Yes.
Are the insurers well set up to have it coming out of the survivor's bank account if it's, let's say, in the bank, from a bank account in the sole name, first is each parent?
Yeah. There's one thing life insurance companies are good at, is making sure you pay your premiums. Right. They will find a way. Now, generally speaking, you'll set these up on what's called a joint life second death basis,
mm-hmm.
which is quite unusual. Like, it's, if you had a mortgage, let's say, it'd be joint life first death, because you want to pay off the mortgage when one person dies. In this case, you don't want it coming to fruition until the second person dies, because that's when the money will actually pass to the children. So that would be common. You can do it on a single life basis if there's only one parent, or the money is going directly from one parent to the children, even though the other spouse would be still alive. But generally, it's joint life second death. And yeah, absolutely, the arrange that's
yeah.
That can be arranged, no problem.
And medicals, do they assume the usual medicals apply? Are there general certain ages on renewal that?
Yeah, well, they do for Section 72, but not for Section 73. So Section 73 is just technically a life policy from the point of view of its legal structure. But unless you first, you know, want to know that if you die, it will be treated as Section 72, generally speaking, they won't have life insurance on it. They'll literally be just a savings plan structured as a life policy. So there's no medical requirement. It's just decide in full and be right
there. But if there is a life policy into it?
Yeah, it's in Section 72, you have to do the full medicals.
And the renewal medicals at all? Or?
No, once you're approved at the outset, that's it. You're
and the premium doesn't change?
No, these are guaranteed for life, absolutely guaranteed for life. Which is, this is the new version of the product. So there was a period of time, say 10 or 15 years, where this went out of fashion. The old version of the product was these endowment policies with profits and investment. These are just pure and simple life policies. You pay a premium, that's the amount you cover, and the premium never changes. That cover will be paid out. You just, all you have to do is keep paying the premium for as long as you pay.
And you mentioned that the person whose life has been insured must pay the premium. If that person is a life tenant, presumably the trustees of the fund, it can't pay the premium before the life
tenant. So I would imagine that's the case. I've never come across it, but I can't see a reason that wouldn't be the case. It's the beneficiaries who can't be paying the premiums, if you know what I mean.
For the Section 73, the policy holder dies within the 8 years, and the beneficiary receives an inheritance as opposed to a gift, say, in the example you gave of the loan to what was going to be for
yes.
10 years. What would be the situation then? We could still, would you just get a fraction of what had been accumulated?
Yes, so it would very much depend on how long you have been paying. It will be a cash value, like at any given time.
How would that still be a tax-free amount?
If it had life insurance attached to it, it's a technicality. It has to have life insurance of a certain multiple of the premium in order for it to be considered useful as Section 72 in the event that somebody dies before the 8 years are up, which is quite easily done. And that may or may not be, the cash value may be much greater than that,
mm-hmm.
but the point is it has to have that technical characteristic.
So it's something additional to be added to?
It is at the outset. Now, I mean, a lot of people will go into these thinking that it tends to be a much smaller sum. It tends to be something like an apartment, 300,000 to 100,000 benefit. You know, so I'm going to put away 10,000 a year for 8 years to accumulate to the 100,000. Whereas Section 72 would be a much, much larger amount. So in my experience, people don't kind of think, well, I want that to be able to do this if I die. But it certainly can be done. But if obviously if it happened after 1 year, there would only be 10,000 in there, so it's only going to make a tiny chip away at the overall situation. But at the same time, it'd be better to get a tax-free than to pay tax on it, of course.
But to get a tax-free, you'd have to have had it convertible to a Section 72, because it wouldn't have 8 years if you died within the
That's
first
right,
year.
You have to have had life insurance on. It won't be like Section 72 where you have 100,000 insured.
Yeah.
It's just a certain minimum amount of life insurance that has to be included in that policy.
$10,000
to the first premium,
yes.
Tax-free.
Yes.
This doesn't provide any change in the taxation for so you're still, you know, for to fund that, maybe with somebody dying in the years, it's going to catch up with that.
Yeah, so the exit tax, yeah, no, it's still, still liable to exit tax. Is there something else we did a note a couple of years ago, we didn't do any public talks on, but something else that came up when we were looking at this whole area is the treatment of exit tax on people's debt, and it certainly is, it's clear to us over the years that there isn't a huge awareness that exit tax can be offset against inheritance tax on people's debt. So if they have their investments structured in life policies, they can offset the exit tax against inheritance tax. So it would be uncommon in older people, and this is nothing to do with Section 72 or 73 really per se, but it would be uncommon in older people who have life policy investments to think, I'm getting old, I might die soon, I want to cash everything in so it's nice and easy for my children. Well, if they built up profits in their life policy investments, that's a crazy thing to do, because the offset is very valuable. And also there's a strong argument, I know some of your members have looked at this, the strong argument that the exit tax that arises on deemed encashments every 8 years is also offsetable on debt. But I'd say there's a lot of estates where people die, they had life policies with investments in it, nobody ever looked at that at all. This is definitely worth bearing in mind. We have older clients who have these investments, and there's an argument that they might want to change their investment strategy. We take into account that once you cash this from one fund and move to another, you've lost the opportunity to offset this on your demise. A bit like CGT or property or shares, you know, people want to keep that rolling up so they can offset it on debt. It's obviously this is one of the things we're trying to do with a fair bit of knowledge and expertise in the company over the years, looking at these issues. So, you know, we've seen it all, I suppose, when it comes to these types of things.
Are you saying that the earlier 8 year charges can be set off on debt as well as the defunding?
No, this is a separate issue really. It's to do with if you have a life policy,
yeah,
the growth in the fund is liable to exit,
yeah,
tax. And exit tax, regardless of Section 73,
yeah,
or anything else, can be offset against
CAT, yeah,
CAT on debt.
But did you just say that the earlier 8 year charges could be,
yes,
set as well?
Yes, because they are deemed encashments. Now, if the exit tax arose because people were taking money out, that's not acceptable. Now, and Andrea's colleague Susan O'Connell and I looked into this area, and I believe the TALC Tax Advisory Liaison Committee went through this with revenue over the last couple of years. It's not written down anywhere in statutes that I'm aware of. It's just that is the interpretation of the understanding that they are, because I don't know if you're familiar with it, but if somebody invests in a fund like this and tax is deducted on the 8th year, and then afterwards they hold on to the investment and it falls in value, they will get the tax taken at the 8th year refunded. Okay? Because it's only deemed, it's not an actual taxation event. It's just you're paying it on account for what might happen down the line. And what happens down the line is you die. It's effectively you are paying that tax on your debt. You just paid some of it on account earlier. I'd say if you present that to revenue, they'll say, hold on a minute. But there is definitely, I'm aware, precedent out there where people have looked at this, and the people of VAs were writing on this, and the revenue have accepted that that's the case. And again, that's a big issue for people who have these life fund investments in later life, and do they hold on to them or do they encash them? My argument would be if they're profitable, then don't. I'm waiting for time.
Anybody else have any questions? Do you want to take one or more questions?
Thanks very much, guys.